So good afternoon, everyone. I'm John Stuart Gordon, the Benjamin Atmore Hewitt Curator of American Decorative Arts here at the Art Gallery. And in normal times, we would be gathering in person out at Yale West Campus, about to start a walking tour of the Hume Furniture Study. Unfortunately, the museum and its study centers remain closed to visitors, but I encourage you to sign up for the gallery's newsletter or to follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and our other social media platforms so that you'll be amongst the first to know when we reopen. Until then, I welcome you to this virtual tour, which has been generously sponsored by the Martin A. Ryerson Lectureship Fund. The benefit of a virtual tour is that we can bring two institutions together and hear two different viewpoints. Today's session, The Layered Edge, a Survey of Plywood Furniture, was conceived of by Alexandra Ward, the Marsha Brady Tucker Senior Fellow in the Department of American Decorative Arts here at the gallery. Alexandra's areas of research span from 18th century uses of coral up to contemporary jewelry. And she was also part of the team that moved the furniture study from downtown out to Yale West Campus. She is joined by Kevin Adkisson, Associate Curator at the Cranbrook Center for Collections and Research. Alexandra and Kevin met at the University of Delaware's Winterthur program in American Material Culture. But Kevin is no stranger to the gallery. He was an undergraduate at Yale College and was an intern in our department. He even gave a few tours of the old furniture study himself. So welcome, Alexandra, and welcome home, Kevin. Some housekeeping. Their presentation is best viewed in a side-by-side mode, which should be the default for this webinar. But when the slides start and you see their faces hovering over the images, you can fix that by clicking on the View Options button, which is at the top of your screen, and then clicking on side-by-side mode. After the presentation, Alexandra and Kevin will gladly answer questions. You can ask them at any point while they're talking using the Q&A feature. I'll be monitoring that and I'll make sure your question gets answered. With that, let's learn about plywood.
Thank you, John, for that kind word. And thank you all for joining us today in this virtual format. Over the next hour, we will discuss how technological advances in creative engineering allowed designers to create complex curves out of this flat material. We'll explore early uses of plywood, including 18th and 19th century examples, before progressing to the 1930s when designers really took advantage of the ability to mold this plywood material into curvy shapes. No survey of plywood would be complete without discussing the innovative work of designers Charles and Ray Eames at mid-century, and then moving the conversation further into the present, we will look at the revival of plywood in the 80s and conclude with examples of turned wood sculptures. We are excited to take advantage of this digital platform to bring together two complementary collections from different parts of the country. Both institutions have important collections of furniture that you can tour in person once the world reopens again. When you do visit us at the Hume Furniture Study, you will see a working library of over 1,300 examples of furniture, clocks, other wooden objects that were made in America or for the American market from the 17th century to the present. Kevin, can you tell us a little bit about Cranbrook?
Absolutely. Thank you, Allie, for inviting me to bring to the Yale audience some of Cranbrook's treasures. And to understand plywood in America, you really can't do it without thinking about Cranbrook. Now, I know our audience today, I've seen some of our Cranbrook members in the crowd, but if you don't know about Cranbrook, before we get to plywood, I just wanted to say a couple of words about what Cranbrook is. We're located about 30 miles north of Detroit, and we're best known as an educational, artistic, and scientific community composed of a pre-K through 12th grade school, a museum of science, a museum of art, and a graduate academy of art. And it's the architecture of Aliel Saarinen remains our house, where we practice, where I live, where I'm broadcasting from today. In the 1930s and 40s is really the moment where Cranbrook, in this golden age of innovation, was leading American craft in fiber, furniture, architecture, painting, and sculpture. And a lot of that mid-century modern look is coming from Cranbrook designers. While this is not a talk about Cranbrook, I would be remiss if I didn't mention the fact that we are still a graduate school of art, and we're still surrounded by about 140 students studying art, craft, architecture, and design. When you think about plywood, though, you might not think about objects of fine art. You might think plywood is functional, utilitarian, boring, rough around the edges, but
plywood can actually be beautiful, curvaceous, and inspiring art. Kevin, though, what exactly is plywood?
Great question. Plywood is a layer cake of lumber and glue, as Popular Mechanics wrote in 1948. And when we look at this cross-section of plywood, before World War I, plywood was known by various names, veneered stock being the sort of main name that was used. But the term plywood was developed by the U.S. Forest Department in the 1920s to help advertise this innovative material, where you took a tree which has beautiful structural qualities, but is limited in sort of size, scope, and engineering. And then you treat the tree and turn it into plywood. So just briefly, how was plywood made? First, you have to log the trees, harvest them. Then you end up steaming the logs in hot water to help break down the cellular structure and raise the water content of the log. Then it's spun around quickly on a rotary cutter held in place, and the tree literally unravels into long sheets of veneer. Then you take the plywood and you clip it, you dry it in a rolling oven. It's sorted for quality, whether you're going to make furniture or structural plywood. And at that point, glue is applied, and it's the combination of these thin wood veneers and glue that makes the material a composite material that has significant advantages over just using a wooden plank. By the 1920s, this process had been refined and advanced with additional sort of developments in cutting technology, as well as in synthetic glues. At this point, the plywood is stacked up, and we're watching a Latvian plywood factory here. And from this moment, when it's glued sheets of veneers, you can then mold and shape the plywood into anything. Now, these photos were taken in the 1990s, but as our first product shows us, plywood is much older than the 20th century.
Yes, these two objects were excavated from the 1920s, in the 1920s by the Yale and French teams digging at Dura Europos, located in modern day Syria. These two shields are the only known examples surviving of semi-cylindrical shields used by Roman legionaries. Looking at the fragment shield on the right, you can see three layers of plywood in use. The inner layer is vertical and the two outer layers are horizontal, which makes sense if you're deflecting blows. You can also see that the shield was wrapped with a textile or a skin along the edge and that it was stitched over for additional strength. Fast forwarding a couple of centuries, we are now looking at an 18th century card table that makes use of glued up strips of wood, a bending technique particular to New York card tables. This detailed shot on the right shows a front rail with four carving vertically laminated layers screwed into the side rails. Now I know what you're thinking. Technically, this is not plywood because they're not set at 90 degree angles. But as Kevin alluded to, prior to the 20th century, there was much more fluidity in the terminology around plywood. And the idea of plywood was really just centered on the use of veneers to glue up layers. So this is, in fact, plywood. Our next object is probably the more traditional starting point for a survey of plywood in America. John Henry Belter immigrated to New York City from Germany in 1840. By 1853, the New York City Directory listed Belter as the owner of a furniture factory on 3rd Avenue and 76th Street, and the shop reportedly had 40 apprentices. Belter is famous for his elaborate Kirsten Card Rococo Revival furniture that recalled the 17th century style of Louis XIV, as you can see on the chair. The gracefully curving forms were embellished with elaborately carved decorations, such as complex flowers, fruits, nuts, and branches. But the success of these ornate designs comes from the use of plywood, which dramatically reduced the weight of the chair, making it portable around the Victorian parlor. Alternating the grain pattern also meant that the pierced work was more resilient and less likely to break. And in curving the seat back, which you can see here from side to side, Belter offered the sitter a more comfortable position to rest in. The detailed shot of this chair on the right, you can see that this is made of three inner plywood layers that are sandwiched between rosewood veneers for a total composition of five layers. Additional carved elements were applied to the plywood back to create more detail. For example, the solid carved crest rail that you can see at the top depicting baskets and flower, a basket of flowers, was applied. So in combining elements that were both applied and using the plywood, Belter was able to provide a design with great visual depth and appeal. And it was also able to offset manufacturing costs, particularly in labor and material. But by no means was this a cheap object. These chairs were designed for the luxury market and cost almost twice as much as other examples of upholstered side chairs. So we're very lucky. Belter patented several innovations for his furniture making in the plywood. Importantly, he did not patent laminating or plywood itself. He states in the patents unequivocally that this was an old, well-known tradition. He does, however, patent in 1858, which you're seeing here, a mode for creating compound curving or molding plywood in two planes at once, an achievement that is often credited to Charles Eames, whose work we'll get to later, but in fact was actually done earlier here by Belter. So looking at the patent, I want to point out a few construction features that made the compound molding possible. Figure one in the top left details the very specific stave construction that Belter was using to make his plywood chairs with. So these are long layers and also short strips of wood. And figure nine details how the short strips of wood are interspersed with these longer layers. Belter made four sets of staves, and each section was individually formed in a caul or a mold, such as figure 10, to give them a curvy shape. Then these four staves were set close to the, which are the ones that set closest to the back of the chair. So your back would be leaning against these four staves with the thin veneer over top. These four staves are put into the mold for figure 14 and 15. They are the first ones that go into that curved mold. And you can even see the pentagon shape outlining these four staves on that mold. And then subsequent layers of more staves are stacked up behind those initial four, slightly offset to give extra strength. Then heat and pressure, it's closed up in figure 17. And you can see figure seven showing a cross section of all these layers. So at the end of the day, it is the short bits of veneer in each stave section that are what enables the flexibility to allow the chair to burn, to bend into these compound molds. So if you look at the chair on the right, which is one of only five examples of this work of Belter's, you can see how it curves from side to side, as well as up the back where your lower back would be. So this is the compound curve. It was very hard to make. You can see it involved a lot of processes and a lot of wood, and which is why Belter made most of his work, like we saw in the first chair, using what he called the ordinary manner of pressed work. And it should be noted here that many furniture makers during this period were employing this ordinary manner of plywood making. And that the reason why we find Belter so fascinating is that his patents survive. And this is why he's credited with this early plywood innovation. So now I want to call attention to Gustav Stickley, the paragon of solid wood and handcrafted furniture, and also a user of plywood. So, okay, I know it's only a drawer bottom, but actually this detail shows how prior to 1914, plywood was primarily used by cabinet makers as a cheap but strong secondary wood, and it was put in portions of the furniture where it could be really hidden. In order for plywood to be seen in all of its glamour and glory, we really have to turn to the Finnish architect, Alvar Aalto. While many of his contemporaries were exploring the advantages of tubular steel, Aalto preferred to work with wood for its direct relationship with nature and its warm touch. I also had an organic approach to design and preferred simple functional forms. And bending wood in the traditional manner with steam could not produce the biomorphic curves that he envisioned. Thus, in the early 1930s, he began experimenting with molded plywood. Stool 60 is one of Aalto's first laminated success stories. He developed a technique where he backsawed slits into a solid piece of birch and then inserted short lengths of individual veneers that you can see on the right. So he inserted these little veneers, and by doing this, he provided the flexibility necessary to bend the wood at a 90 degree angle. This technique became the basis for his L-shaped leg that was an innovative feature of many of his furniture forms. However, it is the Pai Mio chair that was Aalto's most successful design, and it is still produced today. The chair was first made in 1932 for the tuberculosis sanatorium that you see here on the screen. He designed and built this sanatorium in Finland, his native Finland. The building was considered a triumph, merging design with the health and function of the hospital. At the time, the main therapy for tuberculosis was sunlight. And so patients would follow the sun throughout the day, moving between terraces and sitting areas with large windows. Like the building, this chair, here's an example of one of the sitting areas. Like the building, this chair was crafted with considerations of comfort and health. The lightweight wood, the light weights of the plywood made these chairs easy to move and thus facilitated moving patients with the sun. The angle of the seat and the back were intended to aid in the patient's breathing and physical comfort, and the horizontal cuts that you see are for airflow around the patient's neck and head. And wood could be easily cleaned to reduce the spread of the disease, something we are all familiar with today. So this incredibly ambitious, influential design led many designers around the world to dub Aalto as the form giver of plywood furniture, or at least to acknowledge that he established the vocabulary for what plywood would become. What made this chair so remarkable was its form and construction. Aalto was not the first designer to make continuous chair seats and backs with plywood, but the curvilinear organic form was so quintessentially modern that it had a lasting impact. Furthermore, other plywood seats and chair backs were cantilevered or bolted into their frames. Aalto suspended the seat within a supportive framework, giving the impression that the seat is floating on air and almost buoyant. So if we look at a detail shot here on the right, you can see part of Aalto's design engineering. Plywood is more malleable when it's composed of fewer layers or thinner layers, but strength is correlated with thicker layers or multiple layers. So Aalto's approach was to vary the thickness of the plywood sheet to accommodate areas that required flexibility or strength. And you can see here how in the curved section under the knees, there are 8 layers of plywood. And then at the V shape, he inserts those 3 additional layers for support through the bottom of the seat and then up into the back of the lower of your lower back. It goes back into that 8-layer ply. So he is inserting strength into this chair. The ribbon-like continuous bent arms are made from strips of laminated wood, i.e. the wood runs in one grain direction, like we saw in the New York card table. If you wanna advance one slide, there we go, perfect. And what you can see here is that when you use lamination in one grain direction, you tend to have some checking and breakage. And that's what we're seeing at the front of this chair. So the benefits of plywood were just versus regular lamination. And finally, we have an image of workers actually bending this arm support into shape.
And what's great about this image is it shows the sort of mass production techniques that Aalto was beginning to take advantage of. And he was working with people like Thomas Dolliver Church, the landscape architect in California, to begin importing these chairs for the American market and bringing modern design to American clients. I want to point out one thing in the back of this picture, which is this stack of molded plywood seat forms. And this is part of the another chair that was used at the tuberculosis sanitarium. And this is a chair, we have an edition of it here in the Cranbrook Art Museum collection that shows a sort of another version of the plywood seat back with now solid wooden legs. And this chair would really be transformative to a set of young designers here at Cranbrook, Charles Eames and Eero Saarinen. And we see here a little model made most likely by Charles Eames at Cranbrook, held in Eames's own hand, this sort of little gift of a chair. And Charles Eames had studied architecture at the University of Washington in St. Louis. He came to Cranbrook on a fellowship to study architecture for 1 year, and he was sort of such a tour de force at Cranbrook that he was hired on to restart the Cranbrook design department. That's Eames on the left, sitting or kneeling on a plywood display table used for an early display at Cranbrook Art Museum. And he is looking at the young Eero Saarinen, son of our founding president and architect, Aliel Saarinen, and our founding weaver, Loya Saarinen. Eero Saarinen had studied at the Yale School of the Fine Arts. He studied architecture, and he had traveled to Finland to work with Alvar Aalto. So it's likely Eero Saarinen that, consciously or not, brought that idea of the sort of side chair here to Cranbrook. Now, Eames and his design department was exploring all different types of construction and technology. But if we look in the back of this early photograph of the design department from Cranbrook archives, we can see a bandsaw that they would use for their working prototypes. And then we see a prototype of this chair designed for the Buffalo Concert Hall, Kleinhans Music Hall, designed by Aliel Saarinen. And this chair, once it's in use, you can see that it is upholstered and they're sort of lined up together, connected as auditorium seating. But we have to wonder why they upholstered this chair when so much of its beauty in the Aalto design is this sort of thin curve. And it all comes down to who has the skills to actually produce innovative plywood furniture? And so in the American version of the chair, the plywood is much thicker and it's also much more brittle. And so you see this unupholstered version of the chair where there is now a break in the plywood back. And Eames and Saarinen are designing this almost think of it as a tribute to Alvar Aalto, for an American project with American manufacturers, but they're forced by the limitations of American manufacturing to upholster the end product. Now, the next great partnership of Charles Eames, architect designer, and Eero Saarinen, architect and designer, comes for the Museum of Modern Arts. Elliot Noyes, the director of the design department, said that there was a lack of suitable modern furniture for American homes. In a competition brief, he invited designers from across the country to ignore the forms of our furniture existing on the market. Instead of adapting ourselves uncomfortably and unreasonably to what happened to be manufactured, we should invent forms derived from our way of life. This is a photo panel that Charles Eames and Eero Saarinen submitted to the Museum of Modern Art, showing their designs for new organic plywood chairs that would actually have been coated in a rubber finish as the upholstery. Now, the chair on the top right is a little hand-hammered copper maquette, hammered by great Cranbrook student, instructor in metals, and later furniture designer Harry Bertoia. The judges for the MoMA competition selected Eames and Saarinen's entry as the winner in the chair division. And the jury was made up of none other than our friend Alvar Aalto, along with Marcel Breuer, the great Bauhaus furniture maker, Alfred Barr, one of the founders of MoMA, and Edward Durrell Stone, the architect. As coming in first place meant that they were paired with a manufacturer to produce the chairs for display in New York. And in among the treasures of Cranbrook archives, we have these incredible photos of Charles Eames sitting in a mock-up of the chair, and then Eames attempting to create the chair in molded plywood through a series of plaster and clay models. eventually they work and they create this sort of homemade molded plywood mock-up of the chair, but you'll notice that it is really struggling and they are pushing the limits of what you can do to get cross-grain plywood bending at tight, acute angles. And so at the corner of this chair, you see that they cut a relief slot to try and relieve some of the pressure of bending plywood, but they still have these pretty gnarly joints at the corners where the plywood is layered together. It is holding, but it's not something you want to look at. They work with the Grand Rapids Haskellite Company, which had started as a boat and canoe company, and they made plywood airplane parts, but they were not making plywood furniture. And there was a real question of, is there a market for plywood furniture? Eventually, though they can't manufacture every chair that Eames and Saarinen wanted for the MoMA show, they do produce this model, which has a mahogany plywood, and the front is upholstered, not because they wanted it upholstered, but because, again, it was splintering. And so they have to upholster one side, and then the back sort of says, well, this is our end goal, is a curved, double curved plywood surface. Eames and Saarinen also wanted aluminum legs attached with rubber and welded gaskets, but because of wartime restrictions on materials, they ended up with these heavier wooden legs. At the Museum of Modern Art, you see a number of these prototypes, and notice that all of the larger lounge chairs are upholstered on all sides because they could never get these truly complex curves. And so that is a plywood chair completely covered by upholstery. I love at the entrance to the exhibit, from the mind of Eames Saarinen and Elliot Noyes, this didactic display that shows the great beast of the gorilla behind bars. And the gorilla is sort of holding in his cage this older style upholstered wooden and spring-loaded chair. And on the label, it said, this is a chair that devours little children, pencils, bracelets, and coins. And then it goes on to describe the some 64 parts that it took to make a traditional easy chair. And then it compares it to the very limited clear construction of Eames and Saarinen's sofa, which has one curving plywood back and then automobile seat springs and upholstery representing this new modern world. Now, Eames departs Cranbrook in 1940 to marry his colleague, Ray Kaiser, and they head out to Los Angeles. Eero Saarinen will continue to work in Bloomfield Hills, where Cranbrook is located, on his architecture, though he doesn't again explore plywood furniture. It's up to Ray and Charles Eames to continue our story of plywood innovation. And in their Los Angeles home, located in a Richard Neutra designed apartment building at first, they create in the kitchen the Kazam machine. And the Kazam machine was a DIY device for molding plywood. And it's really key to the creation of every subsequent Eames plywood innovation. It was built of 2x4 wooden studs that then connect to flat plywood panels and then spare bicycle parts. Exposed electrical wire within this plaster mold would heat up the surface of the wood and glue, and in 6 hours, it would cure whatever shape they were attempting to mold. They had to use the bicycle pump to inflate this balloon, and that was what was helping to create the pressure on this organic form. Now, the city of Los Angeles did not quite provide enough electrical power to actually create the heat necessary for this machine. So Charles Eames rigged himself up to the power pole outside the apartment and simply bypassed the transformer to get full voltage running to the Kazam machine. And at this point, he was working with Cranbrook alumna, Ray Kaiser. And Allie's going to tell us a bit more about Ray Kaiser Eames.
Absolutely, because in telling the story of the Eames work with plywood, it's important to take a moment to really recognize Ray Eames' role in this collaborative process. Notice this fluid sculpture by Ray at the right. It gives the impression of flowing volumetric folding. It's very free form and organic, and it really highlights the beauty of plywood. This work was actually shown in the Design for Use exhibition at MoMA in 1944, and it was seen alongside plywood molded airplane parts and other industrial plywood objects. Seeing the shape of this work helps visualize Ray's role in bringing the sophisticated biomorphic art design into the Eames's furniture. So I'd like you to keep this sculpture in mind as we move through their furniture. So one of the important things that the Eames got to do is that in the 1942, they received a wartime commission from the US Navy to design stretchers and leg splints that could be mass produced in wood. The War Department needed a leg splint that conformed to the shape of the human leg and would properly support an injured limb by enclosing the heel and extending the whole length of the leg and rounding over the buttocks. It was required to be lightweight and stackable, and it needed to have slits at the side so the splint could be tied onto a patient's leg. All in all, a very complicated design. To meet these requirements, they designed each layer of the veneer with specific purposes in mind. Some areas had cuts in the veneer to facilitate the molding process by reducing stress and allowing for individual flexibility, as you can see in this detailed shot on the right with these little Y kind of checks, which is similar to what Kevin was alluding to on the chair before. Margaret Harris is actually credited with assisting on the devising the proper layers for the splint based on her years of experience working with fabrics and costumes. And you'll notice that these cutouts here are actually very similar to darts in clothing. Other areas of the splint were reinforced with additional strips of veneer for strength following the Alto method. As you can see in this detailed shot here on the left, there's been a little bump out in the splint where they have added those additional layers for strength. Other sections of the veneers were actually interwoven with one another to overlap in order to secure the molding shape that they needed. And you can see this on the picture on the right, there's kind of like a stepped feathery look to the end of the object right there. And that is going to become the heel for the leg splint. And they will intersperse those layers of the veneer with part of the body to create a really strong bond. So how this was made, you take six main layers of veneer, they stacked them up, they added the additional veneer layers where they needed appropriate strength. And then the whole assemblage was placed in a plaster mold, which you can kind of see on the right there. And then rubber straps were secured to the object to press the layers together. And the whole thing was inserted into a special leg Kazam machine, similar to what Kevin talked about. And then the splint dried and they would hand trim it and finish it with sanding. So they made hundreds of thousands of these for the war effort, but after the war, they returned to furniture and applied all of their Navy knowledge towards making innovative and modern chairs. They had at this point abandoned the unibody shell chair that Kevin discussed in favor of a simplified shape in three parts that could be mass produced and thus made available to the lower end of the market. Splitting the seat and the back would also provide more comfort to the sitter by creating two planes that contour to the body. So enter the dining chair wood and the dining chair metal. First sold in 1946, these chairs have an elegant visual profile that became an icon of the 20th century and is one of the most significant and influential chair designs that the couple will make. It's a source of inspiration and frequent imitation. So each element of this chair is independently articulated, which gives the appearance of a seat and back that float off the frame. The seat and the back are each made from single pieces of thin plywood that has been gently curved and molded into this three-dimensional, harmonious, biomorphic shape. To overcome worries about the delicate and thinness of the chair, in the 1946 exhibition at MoMA, where these objects were first introduced to the world, they were actually one example of the chair was inserted into a metal drum that tumbled it over and over again so that they could prove that this was extremely durable. Now, we're gonna look at a couple of details from this chair. The image at the left is gonna show you again how they inserted plywood, an extra layer of veneer to add strength to that system, just as we saw them do with Alto's work, as well as with their work in the Navy. Now, the image on the right is very fun. So Kevin told us about the Kazam machine. And on this image, there are very faint parallel lines that you can see. And these lines are actually as a result of this wood being processed in a Kazam machine. So those lines are coming from the nichrome wires that heated the layers of veneer in order to mold it into this process. And so you can see it on this chair because it's a prototype model and not a finished example. So now looking at the design dining chair metal, I wanted to get a couple of detail shots of the chair's plywood edge because I have always loved this interplay between sheets of dark and light ply. And it creates just this really lovely moment. And when you have such a simple form and a minimalist design, every detail matters and the eames accounted for them all. Or perhaps this is actually the work of Ray. The damage on the left shows that this chair had a long life before it came to the art gallery. And it gives us the opportunity to zoom in and really see those 90 degree angle plywood. That is what gives this material its strength, being set at 90 degrees to each other. So now the final detail I would like to look at for these chairs is the shock mounts on both of them. Eames used newly developed Chrysler car engine rubber shock absorbers to connect the seat and the back elements to the frame. The rubber shock mounts absorbed localized stresses and strains on the plywood. They also provided additional flexibility and resiliency necessary for comfort and durability, because when someone sat into the chair, they allowed for slight movement with their weight. The real issue though was attaching these shock mounts without using traditional joinery or having unsightly bolts go through the face of the plywood on the front. So here too, Eames turned to another wartime technology, electronic cycle welding. This was developed originally for aircraft production, and electronic cycle welding is a process by which an electronic charge is passed through synthetic glue, which causes a chemical reaction that can reliably fuse two different types of materials, i.e. rubber and glue, or rubber and wood, together. So again, very high tech. And for all of you connoisseurs and collectors out there, the oval lozenge shaped on the back of the DCW dining chair wood here on the right is indicative of this chair being a prototype in production, because later these would be squared off and you would not have screws through the spine. And then for the dining chair metal at left, the final production chairs would have their metal washers embedded into the rubber bit. So here you're seeing the washer right up with the screw, because again, this is a production model. So now we will take one more look at the overall beauty of these iconic plywood chairs. And I want to note the chair at the left, which was stained using red aniline dyes. And that's again, that versatility with the plywood so that it can fit into any number of interiors by simply changing the look of the chair.
And I think we can see why the chair has the nickname the potato chip chair, because in abandoning their idea of the unibody wood form, they ended up with these very sculptural seats that remind us of a sort of fried Lay's potato chip. Now, when they moved to Los Angeles, Charles and Ray Eames really become embedded in the entire design community of Southern California. And so their work at Cranbrook went across mediums from film to wood to metal and plaster. But in Los Angeles, they really are advertising themselves and their products through elaborate displays and beautiful renderings, like this pamphlet, section of a pamphlet from Herman Miller. And I love this because it shows their use of photo montage over architectural drawings. And we can also see the detail of the rubber gasket, the metal washer, and even how they've rendered in these plywood layers that are slipping to add strength into the body. And one of the great beauties of these chairs is that they fit in that sort of warm climate glass house. They look good from every angle. And Charles Eames said that a chair should look equally good approached from above or from below. If it's going to be a chair, it should be a whole chair. And part of the creation of these chairs, architects and designers love chairs. They're anthropomorphic, they hug the body. But once you have a modern chair, you need the rest of your home's modern furniture. So we see plywood tables, this one, a giant circle with a raised edge. And that raised edge is going to keep things from slipping off the table, but it also allows a thinner table by essentially acting as a sort of structural beam around the edge of this circle. So it's adding strength. On the right, we see the manufacturing sticker from Evans Products Company, a division of the, or Herman Miller as the sole distributor. And Herman Miller, another great Michigan company led by a Calvinist president who really admired the sort of purity and the clarity of these designs. Why the Eameses were manufacturing for Herman Miller and not their good friend and Cranbrook classmate Florence Knoll was because of Herman Miller's Yale-educated revolutionary design director, George Nelson. Also by Eames for Herman Miller was the folded screen, which could collapse on top of itself into an easy to ship and easy to distribute sort of stack of U-shaped plywood boards. And it's folding across these canvas joints, which are actually layered, sandwiched into the plywood, again, taking advantage of the method of production of layering up directional plywood to then get the sort of hinges as a single piece. And the screen came in multiple tropical hardwood finishes and in multiple heights. They also developed their storage unit system, which in the Cranbrook example has solid wood fronts and then plywood shelves. But they're again taking advantage of sort of mechanically produced aluminum elements and sort of colorful Formica panels to create these room dividers and storage systems. Now, the most iconic work of Charles and Ray is probably the rosewood lounger, which is made of rosewood plywood, leather, latex, down upholstery, and then aluminum, rubber, and steel seats. And it's surprising, of all this Eames plywood that we looked at, most of their innovation is coming between 1945 and 1948. After the war, they'll move into plastics and other materials. And this lounge chair is a sort of last call of plywood with the Eameses. And if we compare it to their early experiments, our Charles and Eero's early experiment, the Eameses never actually produced a unibody plywood chair. And in the lounger, the plywood really becomes more of a sort of luxury symbol than it does exploiting the sort of ability of plywood to move in different directions. However, other designers do achieve production model unibody plywood chairs, like this writing armchair at Yale by Ray Kamai, or the famous and endlessly knocked off Danish architect Arne Jacobsen's model 3107 chair. In our last few minutes here, before we get to all of your questions that I hope you're busily typing into the Q&A feature, Allie and I want to fast forward and look at some later plywood furniture. The 70s were a dark time for plywood furniture, and there wasn't as much experimentation or innovation as designers worked in other materials, plastics, and metals. But in 1984, one of my favorite designers, Robert Venturi, comes up for the Knoll Company with a series of witty, playful, postmodern plywood chairs. And you almost have to think of these as paper dolls, where the plywood as a material is really almost mute. It's materialistic, the material nature of it is really secondary to the historicism of the form, that he is making these Queen Anne's or Sheraton or Gothic chairs, even an Art Deco model. And the plywood is really second fiddle to the actual design, except in those that are covered then in a bird's eye maple veneer, like the one at Yale, where you can see the plywood edge, and then you can actually see a wooden finish instead of the Formica finish on some of the others. And Venturi is clearly, just like in his architecture, referencing historic forms. So the historic Chippendale form has been flattened, sandwiched, and then milled out of plywood. Other designers like Peter Danko for the legacy company, the Thonet brothers, Michael Thonet in the 1820s and 30s had revolutionized construction with steam bent wood. Here you see Thonet entering into this discussion of plywood furniture where the chair has come out of a single sheet of plywood furniture and it's actually stackable. So this is a stacking plywood chair. Now, in addition to simply steam bending the plywood, other designers like Greg Fleischman get involved in computer-aided milling of plywood to create almost pop-up chairs, like very elaborate sort of IKEA furniture that you pop out and then you bend and notch the furniture together. Here at Cranbrook, our continued interest in the legacy of our history and of plywood came to a really beautiful result when the head of our architecture department at the Academy of Art, architect Dan Hoffman, created for a new building at our elementary school, Brookside, a series of molded plywood chairs. And so these little plywood chairs are used at different scales for the three-year-olds up to the five-year-olds and then eight-year-old versions in the dining room. And what's lovely is that he then routes and adds the rubber stopper into these little plywood contraptions. And I have the incredibly heavy and immobile plywood mold still here on campus because these were produced using the architecture students as essentially a teaching tool to make and craft beautiful chairs custom made for Cranbrook's campus in the mode of our sort of construction in the 20s and 30s. If the kids had been really lucky, they could have sat in plywood chairs and eaten lunch off of plywood trays from Swid Powell, designed by Calvin Klein. And this is a prototype in the Yale collection. Allie is going to tell us a little bit more about other sort of 1980s and 90s plywood experiments.
Yes, so if we move outside of the furniture world, we can see some examples of turned plywood sculpture. The first one on the left is by Rudy Asolnik, who was working in Kentucky. And he first started working with plywood because he didn't want any wood to go to waste. So when he had some scraps, he laminated them up and he turned this bowl. And what he was really trying to do was get those plywood layers, which he oriented vertically, to kind of look almost like a grain going around that bowl. And Connie, Mississippi here is also riffing off of Rudy Asolnik's work, but she took it to a much larger scale. And this sculpture is incredibly heavy and also almost 2 feet tall. So she chose to use plywood because it enabled her to work with material at the scale that she wanted to work with, as well as enjoying the layers that it provided.
So I hope that we have shown you that plywood is much more than something that you get at Home Depot to build a fort in the backyard or something that you're just going to wrap your house in ahead of the storm. Plywood is really something that exploits the natural strength of wood as a cellular and linear product, layers it together to create a new composite element that designers for really the past thousands of years from ancient cultures through the Victorian age of Belter into new experiments here at Cranbrook and around the country in the 1950s, all the way through the 1980s, creating these elaborate postmodern fantasies, are participating in the growing idea of studio craft with some of those wood-turned objects. With that, I hope that all of you are much more impressed by humble plywood than you were when you woke up this morning. And we can now take some questions, as I just really appreciate this plywood board more than ever.
Thank you so much, Alexandra and Kevin. That was an eye-opening experience, and you really did peel back the layers of this incredible material. There have been some good questions in the chat. One that I want to start with is from Emily Brock, who she touches on something you mentioned about kind of the new adhesives that were used for the shock mounts, but she wondered, did adhesive technology kind of help drive the design?
Part of the adhesive technology was coming from the fact that the Eameses were in Detroit. And so that joint that they did, they wanted to do as early as 1941. And they were working with the auto industry and the innovations that were coming out of cars to create, that's the whole reason they were even thinking of that sort of unique product.
Also, it's very important, the glues, while we talked a lot about the wood, the glue was actually seminal in this product because the innovations that happened during the war period, during World War II, in order to make airplanes, are what they're applying to make this furniture. So it allows for more adhesion, and it also allows for them to cure things faster and a harder bond using these different synthetic glues that were previously not possible for use for like Belter or even Alto. Alto is bumping off of some innovations that happened from World War I, but the Eames is really good to take that even further because there are so many synthetic elements that allow for more curvaceous molding.
And is, do we know if it's recorded anywhere what these adhesives are? Because this is a theme that's coming up in some of the questions. People are really intrigued by the glue.
So in the ancient plywood, it was all animal glue, and that and Belter was still using animal byproducts. And then once Bakelite comes along, one of the byproducts of Bakelite was an adhesive. And so it is a polymer-based resin. Allie?
One of the glues that the Eames are really using early on, especially, is a waterproof melamine urea formaldehyde glue. And in fact, it's the formaldehyde in this glue, which is kind of also being used in the building construction, which is kind of like tanks plywood in the 70s and 80s, because formaldehyde off-gases and was poisoning people in their homes. And so this glue is very important in that respect, because it then bounces off and kind of has to reinvent the entire plywood industry later on to use something that isn't going to physically and harm us physically with our health. So glues are important.
But you look good while doing it.
This is all fascinating because actually to circle back to Emily Brock's original question, one knows how to deal with rabbit hide glue and other natural glues that people like Belter are using. What conservation issues do these new kind of high-tech glues or chemically produced glues pose for people who own or have to conserve this modern plywood furniture?
Wow, John, what a great question. You know, here at Cranbrook, none of our pieces are delaminating, but some of the student pieces are. So some of the miniature chairs that were experimentations, they're already delaminating. I don't think I can speak about wider conservation issues.
We have no delamination at all at Yale. we don't have these issues. No, that's a great question, but I think, perhaps a conservator could help us more because a lot of their processes need to be reversible. And so they're going to use different types of glues that can also be removed later, but I'm not entirely sure what those would be.
That makes sense. So people are curious, what was it about the 1970s that didn't like plywood?
You have a confluence of events. So you have the changes in technology and the danger of some of these. You also have the environmental movement and the exhaustion of a lot of American forest. And so you're using smaller trees that can't as easily be unspooled into plywood. And then you also have the introduction of particle boards and other materials like medium density fiberboard and oriented strand board. And those are all similar to plywood, but they rely much more heavily on pieces of wood and sawdust, and then it's all the new glues. And so you end up sort of abandoning the idea of plywood as being a really fine furniture element. I think of at Cranbrook, we have a Frank Lloyd Wright house with a plywood kitchen. And if you were to try to create that, you know, Frank Lloyd Wright just says plywood, but you would have to do some custom ordering to get the quality of what was available in 1950 today. And so I think the product changes composition. The trees are not there. The environmental awareness is changing. It's why most of our plywood products now may not be truly plywood all the way through. And they're mostly coming from Eastern Europe, from Latvia and Poland and other places with birch forest and beech forest.
Well, that segues wonderfully to a question that Geraldine has asked, wondering, you know, given the changes in environmental regulations and just access to materials, do places like Herman Miller, is that furniture really the furniture that the designers intended, or has it changed over time in subtle ways?
I think the designers intended it to be affordable and revolutionary. And so these potato chip chairs were $30 a piece when they launch. And they are not $30 today from Herman Miller. So I think fundamentally the idea of design for everyone has left these products.
Also, they were able to innovate. So we showed Oliver Aalto's Pimeo chair where it had that breakage on the front leg. The current version that you buy is using a different glue and also slightly thicker veneer, still in the one direction lamination, but you don't get that breakage anymore because they've designed around that. So these new products also help advance their ideas as well.
Great, so there's been some specific questions. One viewer would like to be reminded of the year that the exhibition with the gorilla illustration happened.
Yes, it's the organic design competition show of 1941. And if you just search that and add MoMA in, MoMA has an incredible digitized archive. And so you'll be able to see all of the pictures, including all of Harry Bertoia's miniature chairs were part of that show. So head online, organic design competition 1941, and you'll see those pictures.
Perfect. And then someone else was wondering why Venturi called his chair Chippendale.
Great question. So the line, I'm not sure if the line had an overarching name, but he simply gave them the sort of most fundamental name per chair. So there was the Gothic chair, Chippendale, Sheridan, Art Deco, Modern, and he is naming them based off of how the plywood was scrolled out. So they're almost cartoon versions of those iconic furniture makers, and he's giving them sort of very explicit names that here is Chippendale chair by Knoll because it is a flat version of a Chippendale form.
Mm-hmm. There's to shift gears a little bit. What about musical instrument making? We've been focused on furniture and instruments may be beyond the purview of this talk, but some people have noted that historically furniture, the casework for musical instruments is often made out of plywood.
Yes, and in the 19th century, there was some patent battles about who actually first designed different types of plywood. Notably, there was a violin that had plywood not only at 90 degrees, but also at 45 degree angles that was layered up and giving it additional strength and different purposes for musical instrument making. But that kind of competed with some of the other patents people were filing for to make the kind of Rococo Revival chairs that we mentioned. So there is a lot of interplay, and these two groups are both woodworking individuals, and they're also using each other as sounding boards and working to see what works in one group and what works in another to kind of make the best of both worlds.
That's really fascinating. For those of you who have been as wrapped by this presentation as I have, please know that this is being recorded and will be put on the Yale University Art Gallery's YouTube page. It takes about a week or two for it to appear there. But start looking for it, share it with friends, rewatch it many times. Kevin, there have been a number of questions, mostly about your background.
That's because there are a number of people in the audience who know that I love an Easter egg bookshelf. So if you have enjoyed today's presentation, do follow Yale University Art Gallery, but also head over to center.cranbrook.edu and sign up for our email list. I do give monthly lectures about architecture and design history, and free weekly tours of Cranbrook on Facebook at Cranbrook Center for Collections and Research. And that is my shameless promotion into my Easter egg background. I have a early Thonet chair for Brookside School that we still use. So not a collection item hanging here, but it is folded plywood. And then this is a Eames potato chip chair. And of course, potato chips here. And then one of the books that was really important to my studies, The Bent Ply, some plywood scrap that I went to the art museum wood shop this morning to grab, and Robert Venturi's grandmother's plate up here.
I actually really love that you have Thonet in your background, because when he was actually the man himself before the company, when he first started working with the forms he wanted to create, he started with lamination and plywood. And when he couldn't get it to work out that way, then he started steam bending solid wood. And now the company has gone full circle back to plywood. So it's actually really perfect.
That is wonderful. Kelsey notes that actually Ray and Charles Eames did make a vertical music tower out of plywood and xylophone keys. So again, we also see that connection of the music industry and furniture design spanning the centuries. One last question that I'll pose, and then at the end, everyone will be sent Alexandra and Kevin's email addresses. If there are follow-up questions or more detailed questions, please feel free to reach out. They can answer what they can, or they can pass you along to the right person, like our conservation staff, because we can't answer questions about how to conserve plywood furniture, but we know who can. One last question is, how does one visit both of these collections?
Well, when the world reopens, which hopefully will be soon, you can visit the Furniture Study, which is at Yale's West Campus in Orange. And when this lecture series ends, or this lecture specifically ends, you'll be sent a link to that website that can tell you how to get there, how to make a Furniture Study appointment, so that once the world reopens, you can join us for tours there.
And Cranbrook, our art museum is open. In May, our historic houses will reopen. I am the curator for the entire campus, so not with just the art museum, but the art museum does run tours through the collections wing on a regular basis on Saturdays. Those have not yet restarted, but hopefully they will soon. And I just want to, as a last thing, thank my colleagues at the art museum for allowing me to share so many of their objects with you today. Part of our mission is to share the story of Cranbrook and spread the good word. So I am glad that hopefully many of you have a new appreciation for this architectural art and design treasure north of Detroit. And when the world goes back to whatever the new normal is, come out and visit us and take a tour of the campus and the collections.
That's very good advice. I think we thank both of you for this incredible presentation. And now for the rest of the audience, your task is to go find plywood and enjoy it.
Yes.
Take care.
Thanks, everyone.